Hello and welcome to the program. I'm your host, Larry Herbeck's Box Lives, Major Nelson. You've downloaded the podcast. Show number, I believe, is 588, Laura. Hi, Laura.
588.
What?
That's a big number.
Now, you know, I want to know this. Hello, Jeffrey.
Hi.
When I'm doing the math. When I started, wow. When I started doing this podcast, you were still in college.
Is that true? What year did you start the podcast?
2004.
I was.
Okay.
I was in college.
Jeff?
I was merely underemployed.
You were merely underemployed, and so I was. So it's what my what a long road it's been. We'll say that.
I do not want to go back to 2004. Those were dark days.
What was I doing? Oh well, I actually enjoyed it because 2004 was such a great time. I mean, Laura, you were in college. You were in college, which is always a great time. So mm-hmm. enough said. If you've had the opportunity to go to college, you probably have fond memories. But 2004, we were deep in the thicks of planning Xbox 360,
yes.
working on the achievements structure.
I'm trying to think. When did it was an OG Xbox game, Jade Empire? When did that come out? I feel like that was around that time.
That sounds about right.
So I sat at home all day playing Jade Empire.
But anyway, and you know,
2005.
Well, you know what? It all mattered because you were in the process of you were being groomed. Little did you know.
I had no idea.
You were being
the
groomed.
Long and winding road that would take me
so,
here.
So if you're sitting home there, dear listener, and you're saying, how do I get into the video game industry? Well, there's a couple ways. We have three different vectors.
We do.
And sitting right here at this very table. Of course, mine, I put that up on YouTube. Jeff, you could stay home and play Jade Empire and then
write a blog
and then
that's how I got started.
And that's how you got started, which was back before blogs were even blogs. And then Laura, mm-hmm. Laura was.
I got a degree in computer science at a good school,
we call it the hard road.
you did the work. We didn't.
And then I got an internship
yes.
during my college career. And
that's right.
Opened the door.
And here we are. So anyway, Grant, thanks for joining us this week. We are now. We're doing pretty well. Two shows in a row
yeah.
that we're all together. So it's
2017 is going well.
2017 is off to a great start in some ways and not so in others. Mm-hmm. So anyway.
One of our favorite Yule Lads.
you know, did you get any feedback on the Yule Lad story last week?
I got a little bit
a little bit on Twitter.
I got some suggestions.
Did you?
Yeah. I can't remember what they are, though. I apologize. Yeah. People who emailed me, I apologize. I can't remember your suggestions. They were really good.
So can
press conference crasher or something?
Correct me. If,
I think there was a DDoS-er.
Can I tell this story, Laura, if you indulge me?
Which
so
one?
I don't know, listeners. I've known Laura a long time, as we talked about. And, you know, she has the worst memory. Your memory is not you. Let me put it this way: your brain is so filled up with so amazing smart things, you've just deprioritized that part of it.
Or she's distracted by Mini Metro.
Right? How's Mini Metro treating you? Let's segue right into what you're playing. You having fun with it?
Oh my gosh, am I? I have not put it down since
I told you. Right?
We talked about it last week.
I told you.
I wanted to know what your most number of passengers are.
I think I got it up to about 1,400.
Okay. I am...
Don't stop it. Come on, overachiever. What did you get?
I haven't gotten there yet.
Okay.
I am just about to hit 1,000. I think that's my highest.
Okay.
I am currently at 982 with this particular layout.
Let me see.
But I knew nothing about subway layouts. No. Yeah. I knew nothing about subway layouts.
Okay.
I grew up in Texas. There are... No subways in Texas, as far as I know.
Well, there's transit routes.
There's buses and transit routes, but subways. So I have been learning from trial and error, and I have currently, it's really fun watching, like, okay, maybe the strategy is different, where I had tried the hub strategy that didn't work, and I tried a multiple hub strategy.
Well, you did have an OMFG moment. That you texted.
Yes,
me.
Because
so I don't know if you know this, Jeff, but on Mini Metro, you can send. It'll do like an animated GIF of your build.
Really?
And so I had a great build where you kind of see all the maps just kind of it's not real time. It's like compressed,
mm-hmm.
and I had sent it to Laura, and forget about that feature. She's like, oh my god, I didn't realize you could make what did you call it?
Circular
loops, because which is the way I did everything.
I always think of London because London has the tube was the first like underground train. And they have the circle line, which is a circle.
Right.
They have like lines that just cut through the middle, like mm-hmm. the central line, or mm-hmm. they go largely vertical, like the northern line. And then they have ones that just sort of go all over the place, like the Piccadilly line. So I'd sort of like try to keep that in mind generally, and then not go on strike, like the like TFL did this week.
Yeah.
So it's I don't know. I just love. It's just such a great game.
I know. Like I said, and are you? Do you play it with the music on?
I do when I can.
When you can, yes, sure, of course.
It's very relaxing.
Isn't it nice? It's just very zen.
Very zen. And when, you know, the little people pop up.
How many lines do you have there? Can I see
this? I have almost all the lines. So this is a hybrid strategy where there are many circular routes. And circular routes, it turns out, are really strong because the trains don't go back and forth up and down the line. They just go around the line.
Right.
So the people at the ends don't have to wait that long.
Look at you min-maxing Mini Metro.
I know.
Now listen, so you are you playing this? How long have you been playing this one?
That particular one is maybe 20 minutes.
Okay. Okay. So I didn't know if you were, I'll get back to you. I didn't know if you were playing it like paused it because you can pause it and you can pause it. You can pause it, which mm-hmm. is super. And now have you paused it and destroyed yes. any lines and rebuilt them?
Yes.
That's the secret, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Anyway.
Because they pop up more stations and then your circular routes need to change
right.
because
it's too big. It's very dynamic.
It's very dynamic. And anyway. It's just so much fun.
I'm glad you're having fun with it.
Oh, yes. Thanks for the recommendation.
Well, you know, you can actually thank, I think it was E on Twitter was talking about it over the holiday.
Oh, really?
So thanks, we actually get him in here to but yeah, yeah we started on that one. And I did the same thing when I was away on when I was on my holiday. It was just like I started playing and anyway, so Mini Metro, we put a link to it in last week's show.
So much fun.
What else are you playing?
I'm also playing Diablo.
Oh, there's a surprise. Jeffrey, are you surprised?
Wait, what is this, a new game?
She's playing Diablo. Interesting.
Because I tried out the new patch we and talked about
you know what
time.
Research, it's for the show. I appreciate it.
It is, it's for the show.
Is it living up to your expectations?
It was really fun.
Good.
So as you guys know, there is a version of Diablo 1 been recreated in Diablo 3.
Yeah, we talked about it on the show last week.
I checked it out. It's pretty faithful. There's the same number of labyrinths, the same type of structure. They tried to recreate the art style. The good news is that you can take your Diablo 3 characters in.
Mm-hmm.
You can take any character that you want in, but they recommend that you start with a level 1 character and jump straight in
right.
to that particular level.
Right.
The reason is because you get a pet at the end of it.
What's
the
pet?
A little butcher.
Oh, you do?
A mini little butcher that follows you around and picks up your goals.
Sweet.
And there is another pet that you can get in that level.
Mm-hmm.
It is a little cow.
And what does the cow do?
A little cow, same thing.
Is it on two legs? Like in the killer cow level?
That's of Diablo 2.
Yeah.
The cow level? Mm-hmm. No, it's on four legs.
Does it have a cowbell?
I haven't heard one.
Okay. Well.
But that would have been a good addition. You can get a cow and you have to do the Wurtz leg deal to get the cow.
I'm sorry, I have to ask. Mm-hmm. We're going to take a little detour here.
Yeah.
Did you have a pet cow when you were growing up in Texas?
is that rude to ask?
I don't know.
Not everyone had steers.
Well, no. I know that Laura's was big and she did some agriculture stuff. You know, you kind of have to in Texas. Do you mind me bringing that up?
No, it's hilarious.
Did you have a cow? I mean, I know your family didn't have any.
Personally,
you personally, okay.
No,
okay.
I did not have a cow pet.
Okay.
I was in 4-H for a semester.
Sure.
In high school.
Sure.
I wanted to raise health, heart, hands, and something else.
Hamburger.
Hamburger.
Sorry. anyway.
Something. And I wanted to raise a goat, but that didn't work out.
Okay.
For obvious
Why not?
Reasons. There wasn't enough space in the high school's farmland to host a goat, and I wasn't about to host it
at
in
home.
Town.
We couldn't have it at home. I don't think your mother would have liked that, right?
No, not at all.
Because they eat, like, everything.
As far as I know,
Yeah, so.
I just think baby goats are super cute. So
true.
I want to raise a baby goat.
Yes. You know you can rent them here in Seattle.
You what?
Yeah, in fact, I remember reading this on
what?
You can rent Amazon if you want to rent them on Amazon.
You can rent goats on Amazon?
There's a purpose for it.
Yes, so if you have some property and you need it cleared, they'll show up and I don't know how it works.
They're more efficient to just like let the goats go because they like eat all the grass down to the root.
Have you rented the goats?
I've seen them. But put them on like overpass. Oh, you've rented the goats.
No, we have my wife is threatening to rent them because on some of our property has blackberry bushes and apparently that's like
awful.
That's
like goat
I've
crack.
Done community service like trying to get blackberry bushes.
Oh, yes,
like that
awful.
Is ridiculous.
Wait, is this when in night 2005 during your dark period when you were out on the side of the road in an orange jumpsuit?
Do you want to get into a community service battle? I know where you've been.
Uncle.
Yeah, so moving on. No, we do a lot of charity work, you know, at Microsoft
right.
in general.
Mm-hmm.
They offer up all sorts of opportunities to volunteer. And so once or twice a year, I'll end up going out. I like environmental stuff. And so I'll go out and we'll harvest fruit in the city. It's amazing how many fruit mm-hmm. trees
yeah,
there are
in
Seattle. And then they'll like send the food off to, you know, like a food bank or whatever. So I ended up doing one a couple months ago, and it was basically,
I remember
guess
this.
What, buddy? I was, there was something about a park. Oh yeah, and it was, ended up being in a nice neighborhood. I was like, do they really need help
here? But
and I was like, watch, it's going to be blackberry bushes, and it's exactly what it was. Oh. like 8 or 9 feet high.
Oh wow.
And I think at the end of Splash Mountain, they talk about like going into the blackberry
bushes.
Yeah. Now I know where that came from. They will cut right through your clothes, cut right through heavy gardening gloves. They have the sharpest sort of thorns.
So I don't understand how goats can eat these.
Yeah.
They're tough, man. Didn't you play Goat Simulator?
Of course I did.
They,
yeah.
They can jump on trampolines. They can skateboard.
They can play soccer.
So true story. We were actually, so this is a little behind the scenes. When Goat Simulator came out on Xbox One, I was lined up to rent a bunch of goats for the shoot.
Oh.
So we were going to rent a whole,
that would've been awesome.
What are all the goats called? Herd? I mean, is it a herd? It's not a murder. That's crows. Jeffrey, to the internet. So anyway, we were going to rent a stack of goats.
A group of goats there's a couple of different names.
Okay.
But it can be a drove, a flock, or a herd.
Okay. Well, we were trying to do each one of those, but anyway, so yeah, you can rent them.
That's amazing to me.
So if you need them, then I agree with you.
I'm sorry. I read it wrong. They were talking about sheep in that case. A group of goats is called a tribe.
A tribe. Oh. A tribe of goats. Thank you very much.
Very good.
Anyway, so I'm sorry. So we're
back to the previous conversation.
Where were
about
we?
Pet cow.
Oh, your pet cow. That's right.
Sorry. I didn't have a pet cow, but I had a friend who raised a cow to show at 4-H.
Right, which is a big deal.
And so it was her pet for a while.
And what was the name?
I don't remember what the name was, but she did have a name for
it. This is that memory thing again we talked about.
Come on. I remember important things, not like my pet cow. My friend's
your friend's
cow's
pet cow's name. Yeah. Okay.
But I didn't get to raise a cow in 4-H or a goat, but my friend did, and we'd go with her to shows.
What's that other H stand for?
Let's look it up.
Yeah. Hey.
Hey.
Oh, hey. Could go hey.
And at the end of it, she did not sell her cow. The goal is to raise a cow, show it, win blue ribbons, and win shows, and then auction off your cow.
Sure.
And she was unable to sell the cow, so she got to eat the cow.
Oh, wow. Wow, that's dark. That took a dark turn.
I did take a class in college called The Meat We Eat. And like the final, literally the final, it was like, here's a picture of a sheep and a pig.
Wow.
And
and
with lines, and it was like, here's all the cutlets.
Oh,
and that's
my gosh.
When I learned that.
You know what's interesting is there's this place in Seattle, there's this company, we're way out of line here. But there's this place in Seattle that, and it's a company down in Texas that makes these patties, these hamburger patties that are all plant-based.
Oh, it's like Seitan or
they something. So apparently Bill Gates is invested in this company. The company's goal was to create a I don't want to say meal or a sub. It's a substance that sounds weird, but this food that was essentially mimicked all of the properties of a hamburger.
Oh, really?
It's got the taste, the sizzle. There's
the
a redness
texture.
To it that's apparently beets, and people can't tell the difference. What's it called, Jeff?
Is it the Beyond Burger?
Beyond Burger. That's it.
Yeah.
And there's a place in Seattle here that sells them. So I want to go down. The place is right near you.
Really?
It's that healthy place down in U Village.
Oh yeah,
the grill.
I thought that was owned by Starbucks, actually.
We'll have to give that a try.
Yeah, right. Because I was like, hamburger. Wait a minute, it's meat. It's plant based, and it tastes like meat. And everyone says it's.
Mm-hmm. Here's the thing, like as a red blooded American, like there's something about it where you're like, eh. But then when you ever watch any sci fi in the future,
yeah,
like if there's like 9 or 10 or 20 billion people on this planet, we ain't all gonna be able to eat hamburgers. Mm-hmm. So.
Well, the whole thing was is the reason they created this company and Bill Gates and a bunch of people invested in it was that I'm not an expert, but the food chain is incredibly inefficient.
I imagine so.
Well, yeah. Like if you eat a vegetable, and I can't believe we're getting into this because
this is a gaming podcast. We'll get back to that in a minute.
But like if you eat a vegetable, they grow it and then you eat it. But if you eat like a cow, they have to grow vegetables for that cow for like years.
Yeah.
And then you still only get one meal out of it.
Yeah.
So it's interesting.
All right. Let's get to gaming, shall we, Laura?
So wait, 4-H. Let's wrap it up.
Yes. 4-H. 4-H.
4-H stands for, and you were very close, head, heart, hands, and health.
Oh, it's head. Head's the other one.
So the head and the heart, I guess, that band, they must have been in 4-H.
Laura, so you were in the 4-H. Now, Jeff, if you and I were in the 4-H, what would those H's stand for?
Hefeweizen.
Gotta think about that.
Yeah. Holidays, yes. That would be Graham's 4-H. Graham's 4-H's are holiday. All right. Anyway, let's go to finish up what you're playing.
So and the other game is Mini Metro constantly.
Yes.
Every free moment.
Yeah, we talked about that.
I have to play on the subway.
Yeah.
So
good.
That's it for me.
I'm playing. Jeff and I have been playing Overwatch quite a bit lately.
Let's dive into this.
Sure.
Into our discovery.
Sure, absolutely.
Discovery makes us feel like Magellan, but somebody told us.
So, Laura, I don't know if you know this. You've played Overwatch a little bit.
I have.
So you won't play with us for some reason, but I'll just let.
I'm no good.
Look, I'm any good? Look, I'll just say this. You typically play the healer. Mm-hmm. The healer classes in this game are fun.
I know, because you've been playing it.
Fun.
But
I would give up my healer class. Anyway. Jeff and I have been playing the game, and we're having some fun with it. But you know, Overwatch, it's not about the KD, it's not about the kill death ratio. But there's a lot of stats that are collected, and the internet has informed Jeff and I of some sites. Jeffrey, right?
Yeah. So MasterOverwatch.com. I'm sure if you're deep in Overwatch, you probably already know about this site or other sites like it. Someone let us know about Overbuff. But what it does is it breaks down your performance with different characters versus the average. And all you do is you just drop in your gamer tag, or if you're playing on Blizzard, like through that account. And it's really, really interesting to see where you're at. Like in healing, I'm top 8% in the world.
Yeah, you are.
He gets the healer class.
Yeah, well, I think it's because I use Lucio
Did you look me up? I think I'm
on. Yeah, I'm looking you up too. So
am I in the top 10%?
You're top 29%.
What? So with my mercy?
We call that a gentleman's C.
Yeah, that's, wow, story of my life.
So what's interesting to see is what the win rate is with each character. So with Lucio, who I've played by far the most, we win 57% of the time. With Torbjorn, is apparently where I'm the best compared to like my other characters, we win almost 70% of the time. And it shows like on average... compared all kinds of stats, like eliminations, KDR, accuracy, and in his case, turret kills.
Put a link off to that.
It's really, really cool. And characters who I thought I was pretty good with, I realized, no, I should not be using Bastion very often, and I should stay the heck away from Pharah.
I also think it's important to point out that, you know, we talk about these choices, you should play so-and-so more often, but it's also, you know, when that map comes up, you're like, okay, what are we going to do here? Yeah. Like some maps, I don't play Symmetra at all because there's no reason to, and some I do in some modes.
Yeah, and if you play to your strengths, then I think you would show that you have high stats. So I don't think it's to main somebody, but rather to say, okay, these are the three or four characters with whom I play the best.
Right.
And it's also good to look at, like with D.Va, my objective kills are like in the 90th percentile and 95th percentile in terms of objective time. My KDR is trash.
Right.
So I'm like, all right, well, you know, am I doing this right or not? So,
yeah.
Anyway, it's really cool.
Put a link to those in the show.
And you can look up anyone else's as well.
Why don't you look up Laura Lollipop?
I just looked at mine
and it looks like they didn't collect the data from the matches that I played. So it finds me, but it doesn't have any data for me.
So
it is too bad.
Larry, you're actually, so when it comes to Symmetra, you're best at, your KDR is well above average. You're in the 75th percentile and you're almost the 80th percentile with sentry kills. You're really good with putting.
Yeah, I know where to hide those little buggers. So, yeah.
So, and then you know what? With, let's see, your win rate is also pretty good with Mercy. And I've noticed when you use Mercy, we tend to win.
Yeah, well, it all depends who we're playing. Yeah, so anyway, it all depends who we're playing with. Like when Lith and I play, he tends to be DPS, and I'm healing the heck out of him.
You're
OP.
Almost an 80% win rate with Torbjorn, and you've played enough games. So hey, maybe jump back on that to stay away from Bastion.
All right. So anyway, playing Overwatch. As I said, we're also I got back sucked back in hard to The Witcher.
Oh, you're still there.
Yeah,
still there.
Well, what happened was I did this quest, Laura, which I thought was broken.
Okay.
And I'm like, why am I keep getting the same quest again? Mm-hmm. I keep completing it and it doesn't check the box. Mm-hmm. Well, it turns out there's part of the dialogue I had to listen to really complete it, I had to do a specific set of things. Anyway, so I'm playing a little
user error.
Yeah. You know what that's like.
I know what that's like.
So I'm playing that, and then there's Witcher armor, so I went off and I collected the feline armor, the bear armor, the wolf armor. I'm just crazy. I'm just having fun.
Are you just lost in
sidequests? Yeah, the world is, I'm just having a great time screwing around and talking to people.
Best side missions in any game I've ever
played. Yeah, you completely. They're just they go on and their stories, and they sometimes they wrap back around to the main. It's just, they're unbelievable. So great writing. So I'm playing that, and then of course we got a lot of other stuff coming out. We've got we'll talk about that later in the show. It's coming out, but Jeff, want to talk about what you're taking, what you're playing, and then I want to take a break because I have an interview this week. So
all right, sounds good. So finally finished Dead Rising 4.
Oh,
right. Been playing that on Windows 10.
That's a really fun game.
Now you can take your Christmas lights down finally.
Yes,
at house.
We kind of leave them up all the time.
You do not. You're not those people.
We have like white ones that sort of have like a nice glow, and we have them. And so like when you're watching a movie, it's not completely dark in the living room. But anyway, it's.
I understand. I respect that.
Thank you.
We have
what
we
are
have
those
some...
lights that go behind your TV? Oh, they give you like the good contrast.
Yeah, they used to be called, on Philips, it's called the Amber light.
Yeah, something that's supposed to be good for.
I have that in my game room. That I have the Hue lights behind my TV. So depending upon what we're playing, it'll light up red, green, blue, purple.
That's great.
Anyway,
super fancy.
Just for mood.
And then after finishing that, I jumped into Halo Wars Definitive Edition.
That's right. I saw you playing that.
So I jumped on last night. And if you buy the Ultimate Edition of Halo Wars 2, then you get Halo Wars Definitive Edition. And it's the only way to acquire it on Xbox One and Windows 10. So Halo was one of those games when I was on the other side of the fence. I looked over there and I was like, man, that looks like a pretty cool game. But I've got other Halo stuff, Wars. Other responsibilities. I never got to it. So I started yesterday. I had no idea Nolan North is like the main voice actor in that game. And they did a good job with the remastering. It's like super buttery smooth. So I'm playing on my PC with a mouse, which I'm glad that I get to do that with an RTS. And
it always helps.
Yeah, it's pretty good. So I'll be playing through the campaign on that and getting myself ready for Halo Wars 2.
Speaking of, loved it on Xbox 360.
Okay.
It was really well done.
Oh, we played that a little bit. I remember that.
Yeah, I got into it.
And I was I'm terrible at it for some reason.
It takes a while to
I get nervous because there's so much going on and I'm like, oh, I got to go over here. Oh, I got to go over here. I get overwhelmed.
It's a very well balanced game. Yeah. Really balanced it like rock, paper, scissors.
Right.
And once you realize that and which one's rock, which one's paper, which one's scissors, then it's much easier.
Right.
Because then you're like, oh, that person's building rock. I should build paper.
Right.
That type of thing. So.
Yeah, I'm not amazing at it. I know multiplayer, I would probably just get destroyed.
Maybe you should go rock, paper, scissors style.
Maybe I should. Okay. I will look out for that. And then Final Fantasy 15, I probably put a ton of time into that.
No. You've put a ton of miles into it.
just driving around. In the regalia. It's just like, it's a cool game. It feels so different. As someone who's played like 10 of the Final Fantasies or more over the past 20 years. Mm-hmm. It just feels so different. It's kind of the weird mix of like fantasy and like 50s era technology.
Cool. It's weird. It is this weird fusion, isn't it?
Yeah.
I noticed that. I played it for a couple hours.
I'll keep going with that.
And then I got back into The Witcher. And
I made a good choice.
Yeah. Anyway.
The Witcher is, everyone should finish that game.
Laura, I think you should finish this game.
I should, as long as I can stop playing the card game.
Gwent's coming out, standalone.
Yeah.
When is that coming out?
When is that coming out?
I think they had a beta.
They did
a beta a couple months ago. So
hopefully soon. Then.
I got to go back because the problem, when Witcher, which is such an incredibly, incredibly rich game, and there's a lot of complexities and nuances to it. So it took me, Laura, it must have taken me 2 or 3 hours just to relearn everything again. Okay, these are the potions. Okay, that's Gwent. Okay, this is how I do that. How do I, that's how I fast traveler. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's how my armor's loaded out. And I got to put the runes in and the stones. So that's the problem is now I'm reinvested in it, for lack of a better term. Jeffrey.
So it looks like the beta is still going. I'm going to link over to the Gwent page, playgwent.com.
Yeah.
If you want to take a look, it says register for beta, so it's possible. Don't quote me on this, but you might be able to still potentially get into that.
Maybe.
And it's got more data on just like what's going on in the world of Gwent. But cool. It's such a well-developed side game.
I was really impressed with it.
Yeah, that was one of where's my tablet version, right?
Yeah.
Right? Because it just lends itself to touch and drag and drag and touch and all that other stuff. So,
well, Gwent will be coming out for Windows 10. So
there you go. I can scratch that Gwent itch. Mm-hmm. All right. All right. We're going to take a break now. We've got an interview with Ryzen, the artist and game designer for Rise and Shine, which is, as we record this, it's out now on Xbox One and Steam. So let's do that. And we'll come back on the other side and we'll continue the show. Joining me is Enrique Cortes. He's the artist and game designer on Rise and Shine from Super Mega Team. Enrique, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Yeah, pleasure's all mine. It's great to see. First of all, I want to congratulate you. Rise and Shine is now available on Xbox One and, of course, over on Steam. A fun little game that came out. Let's talk about what the game is, because the artwork is really very interesting. Tell us a little bit about the game.
Sure, yeah. We tried to make here like a kind of a little mix of different genres here, like platformers, like puzzlers, like a little bit of bullet hells, grabbing some mechanics from other games like Gears of War, like, you know, the cover mechanics, and mixing it up with a little bit of story. So it's a very strange mix that sounds kind of awkward at first sight, but I assure you it works really well, and it's something that you haven't played before. It's very
I want to talk to you guys from Super Awesome Hyperdimensional Mega Team. I love that name of the of your company, by the way. You've had a few games in the past. Walk us through some of the games that you've had before and what the path is that led you to Rise and Shine.
Sure, yeah. We made a couple of games, first on mobile. First one was Pro Zombie Soccer. It was a first game, of course, and it was a very punk game. You know, we made whatever we wanted there. It was a very hardcore experience for a mobile game.
Yeah.
And it was thankfully one of the best games of the year selected by Apple in the App Store.
Yep.
Game of the Week 2. And from that one, we went into our second project as a team. It was called Super Magical. And also it was a far more ambitious project compared to Pro Zombie Soccer. It was also a very hardcore experience. Also was selected by Apple as among the 30 best games of the year on the App Store.
Wow.
Also Game of the Week. Yeah, we're pretty proud of that fact. That was pretty awesome at the time.
Well, you guys have that's quite a. I mean, you've had a short history, but it's been very rich. I will say that.
Thank you. Yeah, we actually like to put out of work in our projects. Yeah, we only release them when they are completely ready. Mm-hmm. So maybe that's why, you know, they say hard work pays off. So hopefully it's just because of that, I think. Maybe.
Now, I want to focus on Rise and Shine, which, as I said, is available right now on Xbox One and PC. What the artwork of this game, and frankly, all of your games, very stylized. I want to talk about what that is. And, you know, as an artist and a game designer, what was your approach to Rise and Shine, and frankly, some of your other games, for your very unique looking art style?
Sure. Yeah. Actually, my girlfriend and me, which are both the two artists in the team, we come from comics before starting video games 16 years ago. That's a lot of time, man. I'm still old now. Yeah, we come from comics, yeah. So we had like a very cartoony style, and that's what we translated into our style making our games. And maybe that's why, you know, we love to have all these cartoony looking games, like very colorful and that. But at the same time, they can be perfectly like very adult and dark and grim experiences, anyways. Yeah. So yeah, that's why.
Yeah, I mean the colors are very vibrant, and I was reading apparently. In this game, you know, everything's hand drawn? I mean, tell me about how you produce the game.
Yeah, exactly. It's everything's hand drawn. Even we approached making each level with like a giant 3 meter wide illustration. You should see our Photoshop files, man. They are crazy.
Oh, I can imagine. Yeah. You must have to zoom so far in to kind of get to the regular level. When you zoom out, it must be just ginormous.
Exactly. Yeah, just like that. It was incredibly tough to make, but I think it pays off, you know, because every step the players take into the game is a different one. You know, you see that tree over there or that collapsed building there. You won't see that anymore anywhere else in the game. You know, it's all made for that part of the screen you are seeing at the moment. It's a big illustration. Yeah, we are not repeating elements like usually. You know, you make games like that. You make like a couple of trees, couple of rocks,
and you're done.
A big texture,
and then
yeah.
You know, control C, control V, control C, exactly. Control V, right?
Exactly, something like that. Yeah, which is fine. I understand. Right. Yeah, but the technology is there already. You know, you can make giant backgrounds if you want to. And I think nobody's crazy enough to do it. Actually, this is only. I think that's the reason why nobody does that, because nobody's that crazy. But yeah. I think it's totally worth it. Yeah.
Yeah, like we're talking about. It's a handcrafted game. Now let's talk about the gameplay itself, because. It's, you know, for Rise and Shine, you've got a character, and tell us a little bit about the character and what the game, you talked about the gameplay earlier, but tell us about the character and the story.
Sure, yeah. The story is kind of a little bit, has a bit some humor on it. Yeah, we are a kid, 11-year-old kid named Rise, and he's living in Game Earth, which is the world where all the retro game characters live. And he gets invaded by this, like, a big space grunt, as we call him in the game, like big muscular guys with big guns and a space armor. which is kind of a, you know, recently or in recent years, all the AAA games seem to have this character, you know, with big guys, high-tech armors and big guns and all that.
Right.
So you wanted them this time to be the bad guys into your game, yeah? So it's kind of making that little joke about the next-gen characters invading the retro gaming world, yeah? Something like that. And this kid, Rice, by accident, is given Shine, which is the talking gun. Mm-hmm. And using all the different bullets that Talking Gun can shoot, you have to actually keep pushing into the game, you know, resolving all the situations you can find.
Yeah, I mean, that's what's interesting is that you've got this boss with this massive gun, the sacred gun called Shine. And then there's puzzles through. You talked about it's a little bit of platforming, and there's a lot of stories going on there. What are some of the games that you use for inspiration for your platforming puzzles?
Yeah, I love games like Inside or Limbo also, or Another World. Big fan of Playdead. They are fantastic.
Yeah,
we want to be like them. Yeah, yeah, incredible. Want to be like them when we grow up.
Yeah, that's certainly a great set of puzzles and games to model yourself after. But you also wanted to bring your own voice to it and your own puzzles to it, which you did artistically. How have you done that with some of the puzzles?
Totally. What we did there was, taking inspiration from these games that we love. What I like about these games is that they keep you interested all the time. You know, every step you take is different. You never encounter the same situation twice. That's what I love about Inside or Limbo. Yeah, it's a different. You surprise the player every step. You know, and that's something we wanted to do here. It's a very difficult way of approaching game design because it takes a lot of work, a lot of prototyping compared to a usual thing or just keep running and keep shooting whatever we throw at the player. But it's kind of we like this kind of games, you know, like a big, well, not big, but a short, close, really polished experience, yeah, where you keep surprising the player at every step.
Now, I want to point out that I should have mentioned this earlier, but, you know, we looked at the artwork and some of the design, and it's beautiful. And when you talk about the heritage of some of your team members, it kind of makes sense. You had team members that work at your company from, they used to work on Plants vs. Zombies and Worms, right?
Yeah, that was me. Yeah.
So if people look back and they're like, wait a minute. So they may not know you, Enrique, but I'm sure they know some of your artwork.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. When we made our first game for Zombie Soccer, people were telling me that exactly, you know, oh, this looks like Plants vs. Zombies. They were like, yeah, well, I worked there. Sorry. Yeah. that's my style, man. Sorry.
So it kind of comes through. Well, listen, I'm going to let you go. I appreciate you taking the time, Enrique, this morning. I want to make sure that people know that Rise and Shine is available now on Xbox One and Steam. So be sure to check it out and hit up at Super Mega Team on Twitter. I'll put a link in the show notes. And Enrique, congratulations to you and the team on the launch, and good luck.
Thank you, Larry. And Enrique, Rise and Shine is out now on Xbox One. Yep. And also another game that hit this week, same day, Pit People.
That's right.
Came to Xbox Game Preview.
Pit People.
So this is the fourth game from the good folks at the Behemoth. And I love everything they do. I'm sure you've played Castle Crashers.
Oh,
you might have gone back to, you might have played Alien Hominid, mm-hmm. Battle Block Theater. Mm-hmm. This game, I've played it a couple times. We had it at PAX. We had it at our open house. It's just, it's sort of like a strategy RPG, but it's, I would say it's a little more sort of simplified at the top. It has co-op. The thing that sets it apart is this voiceover that is really funny.
Oh, awesome.
And it's sort of Bastion-esque, if you remember,
mm-hmm. Right.
Where, you know, you're constantly getting narrated. Mm-hmm. The difference is the narrator is against you and is sort of downplaying everything that you're doing. Yes. And sounds a little bit like Dr. Evil, mm-hmm. a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So he, at some point, I'm waiting for him to proclaim that he invented the question mark.
Here's another thing that you don't know. We talked about Castle Crashers. 1 year, Laura was dressed up as a Castle Crasher for Halloween. I remember that. Were you the red one or the orange one?
I was the green one.
The green. I wasn't even close.
So close.
And I had a lollipop sword.
That's right. I do remember that.
Which I still have.
You do?
By the way. Yeah.
Where is that?
In my office.
Okay.
It's my little trophy from that.
I don't think I've been to your office in like 10 years.
5 years.
Has it? Yeah. Anyway.
And then next month is my 10-year anniversary.
That's right. We got to celebrate that.
I know.
I have one coming up.
But that's right. You just passed 15.
16.
15, 16.
Your job can drive now, Larry.
I've been 16 years, which is weirder. But okay, I don't want to talk about that now. Yeah, I feel old. Jeffrey, we're going to go to the headlines. Yeah. You've got a couple things going on there. We've got it's a quiet release, but a quiet release in terms of games. We got a lot going on.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, you spoke about Green and Orange, and that happens to be, and I'm really stretching this segue.
Look, I have some things to show.
Exactly. We have two.
Yes, I saw the tweets, and you were in Twitter moments.
Did? Oh, yeah, no, I was in Twitter moments for Twitter the controllers.
For the controllers.
So, why don't you? I'll let you.
Yeah, we have new controllers. One is, and I want to get the colors right. Green and orange. Ooh. It's sort of, I guess, if it kind of has like a Halo thing going.
It does when feel first, like a Halo green, like a dark Halo green.
Like, yeah, olive green plus like a fluorescent orange. It almost looks like a pair of Yeezys, I guess. Like the new ones with the boosts with like the orange stripe almost. Anyway, if you like Yeezys, maybe this is your controller.
This is beautiful.
We'll link to it. And then also a just straight up red one, red across the board.
Now this one's a little different, Laura, because I want you to see the red one, because it's got that red.
Oh, it's got dark red as well.
Yeah, so flip it over, and it's more like the Gears of
Blood
War.
Red.
It's two-toned red.
I brought those over just so you could see them.
Thanks, Larry. These are great.
So I don't think you're getting them back, Larry.
No. So this is a red, like a red cherry red on the front, and of course dark red.
Yeah, on the underside,
on the
triggers.
Underside,
and
the inside of the
accent of the sticks.
Yeah, the sticks.
Now these, of course, they have the Bluetooth on them, Jeffrey, so they work with your PC.
Awesome. Yes, they do.
Yeah. So.
And you know, actually, I was reading something. This isn't exactly an Xbox 101, but I had saw someone on Twitter saying, "Hey, my Bluetooth controller, when I pair it to the computer, it's dropping it sometimes."
Yep.
And so I looked into that just to see, and I think on the delightful Xbox One subreddit, which is my favorite subreddit on the internet.
We'll come back to that. It's embarrassing.
But there's two things that you, if you're encountering this, two things I would recommend. One would be to download the Xbox Accessories app on Windows 10. It's a free app.
It's a free app in the store.
And then if you just hardwire one time your controller to the through USB to your computer, it'll see it and you can update the firmware on your controller. That will help.
Yeah.
If you're still encountering some issues, it might be in your power save settings. So if you go into Device Manager and you go into Bluetooth, just look for ones that say like power or energy saver controller and then certain configurations to save energy, it'll sometimes shut off Bluetooth and that will make it so that your controller won't pair, or other things as well. So you can just uncheck that and that should be able to help you out.
Thank you for calling Microsoft Technical Support. After this call, there will be a survey.
You know, I did do tech support. That was one of my first jobs on Gateway Computers.
Gateway Computers. Oh, speaking of cows.
Yes. Yeah. Full circle.
I was saying, have you tried turning it off and turning it back on again before it was cool?
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. That's okay then.
And then I was like, you reboot it and I'm going to hang up now.
Are you taking pictures of that, Laura?
Can I?
Yeah, you absolutely.
They're very pretty.
Yeah, so we're...
You know, you can just go to majornelson.com.
I also
but
have...
But I don't have my fingers in them.
I have...
Trues.
You didn't ask.
Other news. Some new Gears of War 4 Series 2 cards.
Wow, yeah, this is big.
Were announced. So 280 new cards. I ended up playing another 50 rounds of Horde this weekend, and there's some really, really cool skins for weapons. So some new characters as well. Zombie Min. There's a Gear Corps, Armored Anya. Anyway, there's a bunch of stuff and a bunch of both animated and static weapon skins out there. So if you're playing Gears, you'll be able to find those within the game.
Yeah, if you want to check that out, I do a little show on the console called This Week on Xbox.
You do?
The kids call it TWOX.
We did. We internally call it TWOX.
The kids.
Yeah, TWOX. So I actually cover a lot of this in that as well. So if you want to hear me, you can hear us here. You want to see me, and really you don't want to see me, you can look on your console. I'm usually in the right lower right. I'm sure you've tuned in and seen me.
I've seen you.
Oh, you have?
I have seen you.
Yeah.
Many times.
Yeah, it's funny. When I was out at the holiday, when I was out with my family, I have my nieces and... They're like, Uncle Larry, why are you on the TV? They're like, oh, how did you get yourself there? Well, it's what I do. Why? It was a weird conversation. Right. Anyway, you can find me there.
We're talking about Halo Wars.
Yeah.
Halo Wars 2. There will be a multiplayer beta available next week, January 20th. So if you want to give the new Blitz mode, which is the one that I can tell you, we'll show it to media. I think there's actually a tour going on right now. people really like this Blitz mode, and I think it brings people in who maybe think RTS is not for me. Definitely makes it very interesting and balanced in a good way. So you can try that out. You know, don't take my word for it. That's a LeVar Burton.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks. Yeah.
Reading Rainbow.
Thank you. Or Jordy LaForge. Anyway, mm-hmm. You can try it out yourself, and that will begin on January 20th.
I met him in Las Vegas.
I met him in Las Vegas too.
But we were at that Capcom thing, right?
No, all right. So that Capcom, were you at that Capcom?
Yes, thing? Remember that?
For Street Fighter 4?
Yeah, that was up in
that was in L.A.
No, there was one up in a hotel.
Oh my God! Yes, that's
remember
right.
that?
So LeVar Burton
Chris Kramer brought us there.
He did,
and LeVar Burton walked in.
Really?
Wow.
Where were you? You were there.
I was there.
Yeah, I was there too.
That's crazy.
Anyway,
what is he like?
What is it? Very nice. When it first opened up.
He's very nice.
Does he like his character on Reading Rainbow? Is he very friendly?
Yeah. I have a picture with him. So I ended up doing a panel with him at CES.
About what?
About social medias or something like that. It was him.
What's that?
And it was, I know, right? You have to understand, in the 2000s, that was a big deal. And it was someone from Zappos, because they did some interesting stuff. And I was like, I can't believe I'm sitting next to LeVar. I was basically fanboyed out the entire panel. Mm-hmm. Real good for the people watching the panel. They're like, yeah, we get it. You like LaForge. Yeah. But it was cool. And then he saw him again at Street Fighter 4.
That's right. I remember that event.
That was a crazy event.
That was a bizarre event. Anyway.
Anyway, sorry. Yeah. It was a
very... Sorry, Laura. We just...
very interesting.
Jeff and I have crossed paths unknowingly a few times.
Yeah.
Probably
yeah.
Well,
I knew.
A few times.
I knew usually. Although I didn't know you were in that... Oh, the Mad Catz guy was there at in that hotel. That was when I met the controller people.
That's
I ended
right.
up modding a controller. I got... Someone gave me a modded Street Fighter stick for my wedding.
Oh,
that's an unusual. That's an unusual wedding gift.
It is an unusual wedding gift.
But it was. I appreciate it.
Gift that keeps on giving.
Exactly. So, anyway. So the beta for Halo Wars 2 next week, and then I'm very excited about this. Now available for pre-order and pre-download digitally on Xbox One.
That's right.
Mass Effect Andromeda. I cannot wait. Actually, there's supposed to be some new information coming out, some new trailers coming out this weekend.
I hope so.
So I'll be keeping an eye out for that. But they are coming down the home stretch. That game comes out on March 21st. So we're just a couple months out. I'm in furious backlog mode.
I know you're trying. You won't even play Overwatch when you're like, I got to get through this. I got to get through this.
I got to finish everything, because once Andromeda comes out, that is where I'm going to be.
I understand.
So excited.
I understand.
They made a couple other games now available. Nevermind, which is an adventure thriller game. I don't know too much about it other than the cover looks like it's from The Mothman Prophecies. I don't know if you ever saw that movie.
Of course
that
was
a creepy movie.
That was very creepy.
And then Acorn Assault. Squirrels are involved.
Squirrels
are involved.
Do you have squirrels in Texas, Laura?
Oh, yes, lots of them.
I used to have a squirrel. We used to have a family of squirrels that lived in our trees near our house, and they would throw acorns at our cars.
No, really? That's just mean.
I know.
They would throw them?
They were walnuts. They were walnuts because we lived on a...
Bigger ones.
Yeah. I remember because they're kind of squishy.
What did you do to upset the squirrels?
I have no idea. I have no... To this day, I don't know.
Oh, no.
Must have been all the dogs we had.
That would be it.
All right. You know what else is news this week that, we can't really talk about because we're recording this right before the announcement is Nintendo Switch stuff.
Yes.
That's happening. So we'll have details on that.
Yeah, I'm really interested to see that.
What those guys are, good friends at Nintendo. Always up to something over there, those guys.
You could throw an acorn or a walnut.
I could. You're right. I could whip it over there.
From where we are, we can hit them with an acorn.
Look out, Reggie. So, all right. So we're cooking along. You know what we have to do?
We have a name the game. Yes.
I keep forgetting that you too. I do. So are you ready with that?
I am. Let's roll the name the game. That was Name the Game from last time, and it was Stardew Valley.
Have you played it?
I have not played it, but it's on my list of things to play very soon.
Yeah.
I'm very interested in it.
Because it's got,
it's an economy game.
It's 4 H's.
The head and the heart approved.
There may be a cow in there. Anyway. So what do we got? Starting
all right, so the winner this week who got it correct is Jack from Cambridge, England. But tell Jeff he's originally from the red half of North London.
Well, I appreciate that. Okay. He's his I'm national sorry. Supporter.
You, oh, I see.
I'm
I
going
see.
To another match soon.
I know you are.
I'm going over there for a meeting. We tend to schedule them around Arsenal home matches.
And I think you probably won't be able to see Graham because, again, he'll be on holiday.
Well, Graham, you're welcome to come join us. Although I think he likes another team.
I'm sure our friend in the UK would like to know what they won, Laura.
I'm sure. He's more interested in that.
Yes, then.
And Jack, this is what you've won. You've won a copy of Silvio, which is an ID at Xbox title that released this week.
Yep.
Friday Night Bullet Arena, also an ID at Xbox title that released this week.
Yep.
Dead Effect 2. Pit People, which we talked about earlier.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Never mind.
Wow.
Acorn Assault.
Look at this.
And that's not all.
Wait, what?
A copy of Rise and Shine, which we heard about.
We heard about earlier previously. In the show. Yep.
And.
Yes.
The Elder Scrolls 5 Skyrim Special Edition.
Ooh, that's a good one. That's very a good, good. One. Yeah.
I haven't played that.
And again, that's not all.
Oh, come on.
That's not all.
No.
He's going to win yes. that controller.
This red one.
The Xbox Live controller, red.
You yeah. got to give it back now.
Yeah.
I know. I have to.
It has Laura's fingerprints on it. So be warned. No, it doesn't. We'll give you no one.
That's right.
So we'll congratulations.
Yep, way to go, Jack from Cambridge.
Jack, congratulations. Thank you for tuning in and listening to the show. You, dear listener, mm-hmm. it's now your chance to win. Laura,
that
how do they win?
Right. If you, too, would like to win all kinds of fabulous prizes, it's very simple. All you have to do is listen to the sound effects that I'm just about to play.
Yes.
And then send me an email with what game that's from.
Are you ready?
Yes, so let's roll the sounds.
Are you ready?
Let's roll the sounds. You know what game those sound effects are from, all you have to do is send me an email, lollipop@xbox.com and ccmajor@xbox.com.
Yep.
It's that simple.
You know, when I used to do this feature, you know, I would go on and record it, and people could tell on Xbox Live, because I record it from what I'm playing, they could tell what my previous games were, and so they were able to narrow it down. Now I do it under a separate account.
I see.
Because they were wise.
They're very wise.
They were wise.
And I do want to let listeners know, if you do want to participate in this game, please do. It is from released games only. I had some people guess some unreleased games like Sea of Thieves, things like that. Those are not released yet. So we are only choosing
released games. Now, and let's be clear, games. It could be in game preview.
It could be in game preview. Right, that's true. But you can download yourself and play it at home.
Right. There's no betas or none of that.
Yeah. No betas, no unreleased games.
All right, Jeffrey, you seem to be puzzled over there looking at your computer.
What? Oh, I'm just, I should stay off Reddit while we're doing a podcast.
We're not going to talk about Reddit, are we? I really don't want to.
Oh, yeah. No, let's talk about that. So, Reddit is the one site, like, I try not to look at email on the weekends, but I always like to see, you know, is everything all right with Xbox Live? Anything I need to be aware of?
There's but I'll text tips. You if there's a problem. You know
I know,
that.
But I probably like 3 or 4 times a day on the weekends and more on the weekdays, I'll head over to the Reddit, the Xbox One subreddit, which again, I think is like very... One of the good level of decorum, I would say it's better than
the mods
Reddit
do a good
launch.
Job over there.
Yes. Yeah, very good job. So I noticed a couple threads about you,
me
specifically, Larry. Yeah.
Specifically, Larry.
Yeah, yes. Yeah. And one was I think the Major Nelson appreciation thread.
Oh, that's a nice thread.
It was highly embarrassing. I went in and commented. It was very nice of them, but I just you know Laura, you know because we've worked together a long time, and Jeff as well. I just happen to be in the fortunate or sometimes unfortunate position of being one of the public faces of Xbox. Mm-hmm. I mean, I love my job and I love it, but there's thousands of men and women and people that are behind me and but with me and that are doing, they're frankly much smarter than me, that are doing harder work than me. So I always want to remember those guys.
Really looking at Laura a lot. I all those things. And like, I'm like over here, like praise me, notice me, senpai. And it's not happening.
So anyway, I want to be very clear that it's not just, I'm not a one man show, and I just happen to be I'm fortunate enough to do that.
That was though, however, like the equivalent of the Reddit Lifetime Achievement Award. I feel like you just won.
Oh, yeah, it was. It was very nice. Great. It was very nice. And we have, I mean, I hang out there frequently because there's a lot of questions I can quickly answer. I just don't, you know, I don't have a lot of time during the day to just kind of browse the internet because the internet can waste your time
sometimes.
So I, but anyway, that was yeah. So what else did you pick up over there, Jeffrey?
No, I'm looking. People are talking actually about the Gwent beta and who's in it. So yeah, it's just you know, I'll just link to it. It's a good resource. I would say like any non-affiliated website, occasionally a little traffic and rumors. The thing I do like about this thread is the mods will, if it's false, they will very quickly mark something false or opinion or unsubstantiated or whatever. So it's just a nice way to find out. It's a good aggregator of like all the stuff.
Yeah, they do good work over there. They do really good work over there. So anyway, what else you got there, Jeffrey? Because otherwise we'll wrap this puppy up. And
we can wrap it.
All right, we can wrap it up. Laura, you got to get back to work, right? To your mysterious office with your lollipop.
With my lollipop sword.
That's all right,
you can always find me.
Yes.
Looking for the lollipop.
Look for the lollipop. You can also find her on Twitter at
Laura Lollipop.
Find Jeffrey at
Jeff Rubenstein.
And again, we talked about it last time. Just go find me at Major Nelson, and they're part of the small troop of individuals that I follow.
That's true.
Because I handle it through lists and whatnot. So no one ever got back to me whether I should unfollow E or not.
You shouldn't.
Remember we talked about that last week?
Again, I feel like he's had his jersey retired.
Now, I got to tell you this, Jeff. You don't remember this because you weren't with us yet, but Laura remembers this. When Twitter first started coming out, and he was so violently opposed to it. He's like, I don't understand why anybody would want that. Right? Do you remember that?
Yes, I remember that very clearly. Yeah. He was so against it.
He was so against it.
And then we did make fun of him for a little while after he signed up.
And then he, not only did he embrace it, he wrapped his arms around it and brought it home and tucked it in bed. I mean, he just...
Good work.
I don't know. So he, anyway, I don't know. So that's why I kind of feel like I should follow him because
we got him into it.
Because we got him into it. That's kind of what I'm getting at here. So
you're responsible for what happened.
Responsible for that whole thing.
Plus, you can harass him about Pokemon Go stuff.
Yeah, now that he's over.
Like, Pokemon. Why is it so hard to find a Kabuto?
I don't really care, but thanks. Is this an issue for you?
Yeah, the whole Nest thing is very complicated.
Okay.
There's a Pokemon Go Seattle subreddit. That's another one.
Nice.
Where we're hanging on. We're looking, we're reading the tea leaves and auguring the goats and grabbing on everything to like figure out.
Figure in the wind.
I just
are you renting the goats?
I ought to.
Yeah. That could help.
If they can, I can put a tracker on them and they can rack up some candy for me. Anyway, that's hashtag Pokemon Go problems.
I may have Graham maybe joining us in a couple weeks.
That'd be great.
I think I mentioned that earlier. He's
looking forward to seeing him.
Going to hopefully join us. He's going to be over here, and I've
on annual leave, right?
On annual leave, I've extended his I've extended an invite to him to join us because he's always welcome on the show, and he's I get a lot of people that want to be on the show, and I decline them all. You have to meet a certain bar here. Part of it is to be able to walk.
I don't know if I meet that bar.
Is that what I tripped over when I walked in here?
Can you fog a mirror? So. No. It's all right. We're gonna let you guys go, and we will talk to you guys next time. Right, Laura?
Sounds good.
Thanks, guys. We'll see you next week. Bye bye.
See you online.
Bye.